Okay, I have like half an hour, and I'd like to show you what we are doing for a customer of ours, Tim and Melov. We developed an iPad application for schools. So kids starting from 12 and up are using this in their schools already, and we made a platform using iText and Google App Engine and native iPad development to make what we have here. Also note the red sign on the right. Okay, today, short introduction about Q42. My company I founded like 12, 13 years ago already, in 2000. I'll present shortly the case, what Tim Melov, which is an educational publisher, what are they doing, why, what's the case, why are they aiming at this big. And I'll give you a demo, talk about technical architecture, another demo, and the future as we see it in the short term. So I hope I'm not going to break the record of being precise on time. I'm known to take a lot of time, so please wave if it's going too fast or too slow. Q42, this is what we are, basically this. We're all engineers, we have like 42 people even, so this is brilliant. We cannot grow anymore because Q42 can only have 42 people, right? Well, no. But we have 40 engineers, which is brilliant. We don't have any overhead, it's all engineers, we're all nerds together. And we work together with our customers to make, make cool stuff. And the end, the thing, everything we make, we think, okay, how does this make that the user can kick ass? The end user is everything, right? If the user feels like, oh my God, this is what I made, that's the mission. That's what we try to do. Some pictures. This is the office. Okay, the case. This is actually, let students learn more efficient. That's basically what we want to do. So get higher grades, finish earlier. And of course, well, the vision is we make it, we assume students, you have their own personal device. They're not borrowing it from the school or whatever, or they're not giving it away to each other. It's your personal device, it's your work. I don't know if any of you, how many of you have an iPad or a tablet or? Okay. I think you'll notice that it will only work for you if it's your own. If you borrow it for a week, it's like a browser, right? But if it's yours, it starts to grow on you and it's becoming your own. You start working with it. Well, basically, that's our assumption. It's a personal device. So in school, kids going to the first I don't know in English, but 12 years old, going to school, and you freaking get an iPad. Aren't we jealous, all right? We all had boring books and stuff, and those kids are getting iPads. Imagine the first day at school, right? Cool. Okay. Well, some numbers. In 2011, in January, we released version 1.0 and started pilots with schools. And we're still going strong. We're still in a pilot phase. We have now 26 schools actively using it, and about 2,000 active kids actively daily using the iPad every day. So it's quite interesting to see. If you sit next to them, you see totally new problems evolving in schools, like kids playing around and not paying attention and doing games and communicating all the time, but also really well know what they can do with it. They can play around with it, find images on Google Images, store them, make notes, share it with each other. It's brilliant to see how fast kids, like 12, 13-year-olds, play around with that. There are now approximately 20,000 personal notes tracked, but we're only counting this for 4 weeks. So this is 4 weeks of notes taken, which is quite cool for only 2,000 students, right? Quite interesting data. Target audience in Netherlands is around 900,000 kids, where we're aiming for. So that also gives us some focus and claim on the server-side architecture we need to support, right? Every school starts between 8:30 and 9 in the morning. We got shitload of traffic, right? Because everybody is starting at the same time. So you need to be ready for that. But you don't want the same infrastructure and power on a Sunday. So stuff to think about. Technology-wise, this is what we are running on. Server-side, we're running on Google App Engine. How many of you know Google App Engine? Really? Cool. usually it's not so known. How many of you have seen the dashboards of Google App Engine, how it works? Okay, not so much. So I'll show you something about that too, because it's quite interesting to see. Basically, the Play framework helps us in a Java stack, and hopefully soon to Scala, just to only code what you want and don't bother with all the other stuff. It makes development really fast. We're using iText only right now for PDF encryption. And we're programming two clients, one iOS native, so that's iPad, and one HTML5. Demo time. Already? Okay. Let's see where it is. Okay. I can see if I can change. Okay. So, kid signs in. You can just, it's a free app. It's called Schooltas in Dutch. So in English, I think it's called school bag, but it sounds really a bit strange. But what's the good English word for a
school bag?
School bag? Okay, school bag. That's what it's called, and basically it's a school bag. It's everything in your school bag is now in this one. So they bring the iPad. You just sign in, enter your email, you get a password emailed, and you're good to go. Then on the left you see your courses. And how can you see your courses? Well, this is it. You have bundles you can enter, and the publisher just gives out hands out bundles, and you type it in. And I just made, this is a live, I didn't try this, so this is going to be fun. It must go down and break, but we'll see what happens. I uploaded the PDF of this presentation into the platform, so, and I didn't try it yet, so we'll see what happens. And the code, is everybody, you can try this one. I unlimited this code. iText PDF for the win. I have no clue if it works. Here it is. Here's our book. Thumbnails, everything is there. It's already encrypted, at least let's hope so. I'm going to download it. So you need to be able to work offline, so the book is there. Let's see how the bandwidth is doing over here. This is from the Google CDN, so we don't, if every cool kid's in September, right, 900,000 kids downloading their books in one day, it's going to be a lot of bandwidth, right? So you don't want to host that on your machine somewhere in Amsterdam or anything, you just want the CDNs. So, quite interesting. So I got a book, right? Let's see. Here's the book. This is the presentation, but let's do something more interesting. Let's go to English. Let's go to a book here. So here's my book. I can double tap somewhere. I can tap back again. It's just a reader, but it's a good reader. I could just go to several pages. But that's cool. As you can see here, this is the 2.1 release. It's not yet in the stores. It will be in 1 or 2 weeks. We're releasing it in the store right now, but it takes a week or something. This is enriched information. So right now I can just play the English audio file. So yeah, it's coming from different data sources. We combine that. So basically what we did, we have books, and we have a search engine, which looks for enriched data and put it on top of each other. Right now it's video and audio, but of course you can think a lot further than that. So, you can do practices, you can do games, you can do gamification there. It's all the starting point of the enrichment of the books itself. Also, you can make notes, right? You just can make notes, you can type something, you can store it. You can also put a marker here. Let's see. Like this. And now it's combined with this marker. Let's see if I can place it somewhere else. I can put some tags in there and I can save it. So it's now in my English course. I did some stuff, but I can see all my notes here. I can favorite stuff. As you can see on the left, you can see it's not being synced net, so if you're on a bus or something, you can just do everything you want and it's synchronized like Evernote. And you can see all your notes. But of course this is a little bit boring, so let's say we're going to do some more. Let's add a picture somewhere. Whatever, well, there's some scary kid over there. So I added a picture. And basically this is how kids are using it right now. And we're doing field tests for already over a year. And we have a roadmap for the until December, with a lot of new features, of course, where kids are playing around, delivering homework to their teacher, teacher seeing the activity of everything. Well, sky's the limit, right? So, this is it. You have some stuff to manage about this one. Of course, you can do your own, manage your own stuff. And you have your notes over here. You can also, without having a book, you can take notes too. Cool, eh? Well, I think it is. Okay. There was demo one. Questions about this one? Yeah. Like this, let's go to this one I added here. So I choose this one. Wait a sec. What I can do, I'll share it with the world. So you can share your notes, place it on a book, and share it with the world so people can see it. So if I look at this right now, I can say I want to see other stuff. I want to see different sources and combine it to me, so I can see my own class or my own school even, or I want special sources, or and you combine everything. Well, this is just a layer on top of the PDF, but for kids and for schools and teachers, this is quite strong, and they're using it quite intensively. So now, of course, we have a beautiful moderation problem of kids making. We found pages where people place markers, and of course, you can't do swear words, right? Because we have moderation. So what are they doing, smart kids? They're making a lot of markers and spell out the words in separate markers. Our moderation system, of course, isn't equipped for that. So every marker is no problem. In total, it's a swear word on a page, right? So yeah. So it's a new era. We don't know what the next problem is. So we're just moving ahead. We're releasing every month, and we're just learning from what happens, what works in the school, and what doesn't. Yeah. All right, I'll continue. Here we are. Technical stuff. I assume most of you guys are technical. Are you programmers? Who of you guys are programmers? Oh, yeah. You saw the red sign, right? Okay. Good. Okay. Well, there's a lot of stuff to be talked about, of course, but basically, we have books. PDFs. That's what the educational publisher has, and you want to share it with the world. They're already printed, they distribute it, and this is a new way of distributing it, right? So this is what they have, and they have a lot of enrichment. They made a lot of stuff. Fun calculating games, practice tools for learning English and French and stuff like that, and doing achievements. What we made is a platform online where we can deliver everything to our appropriate clients. And, well, I'm focusing on what we do with iText and what we do with PDF specifically, because, of course, the platform is about authentication, identification, all the enrichment and search engine stuff, but I'm focusing on only this part right now. We deliver through the iPad using a DRM, but basically we just encrypt the PDFs using the bundle codes. So if you have a bundle and combined with the book, is together, has a set, and that's what encrypted and sent to the iPad, and the iPad decrypts it because it has the bundle code too. I know it's not in your ballpark and it could be 10 times better, but good enough for us. You know, you can also copy a book on a copy machine, right, on a Xerox, so why bother? Why just trust them? That's good. So we do encryption, server-side, we do rendering right now. That's basically for the HTML5 version of this application. We use it for CDN delivery because of the bandwidth. We have a lot of images and a lot of PDFs to go out there. And step four, we need to implement a nice way of full text searching, but not on the client only. I want to have the HTML and iPad version exactly the same. So we want a server-side way of knowing the PDF's contents and do good full text search, including the enrichments and stuff like that. And we haven't figured that one out yet. So any hints and tips? Please. I know for rendering I can talk to you, but it's other stuff. Okay, so let's talk about the PDFs and the encryption process. We're using Google App Engine, which is freakingly cool. If you don't use it or play around with it, play around with it. It's a happy place. You want to be there. If your legal advisor says yes, go there. We use it with our 40 people and it's a lot of fun. We have books, we have bundles. Together with those, we want to encrypt, so we send that to the task queues. Do you guys know, the thing here is scale. This platform will be big. It's only in Holland, we have 1 million kids, right? And it's going to scale up anyway, it's going to be bigger than this. So we shouldn't go down with our own success if it goes well, so we need to scale. And the encryption is a process, takes only a few seconds, but then the PDFs are like 150 megabytes sometimes, so it takes some time to get them out of the cloud, do stuff, put them back in. So what we are using is task queues. Anybody familiar with the task queues concept of App Engine? Brilliant. If you're using Google App Engine, task queues. It's really an interesting place to make solid software. The thing is, a task queue, you just put a task in a queue, and what the task queue will do is it will try to solve the task. And the task is nothing else than an HTTP call to the URL you define. If your server responds too slow, to a timeout, if you take too long, so let's say 60 seconds, or if you deliver an error code, it will retry. And it will be trying until he gets a 200 OK. So if something went wrong, bug, code, whatever, your task queues will be there and it will be there forever until you fix it. So if the engine is going down, is there problems? So you code for errors and then the platform will get more solid. It's quite interesting to see what happens there. So we know, okay, we need to encrypt this book. We tell it to the task queue. Then we use Google App Engine backends to do the calculating work. Because we need a lot of memory, and the front-end servers are like 128 megabytes of RAM or something, because they're cheap, but we need 1 gig of RAM for the encryption. And when it's ready, it sends it back, and the encrypted book is sent to the iPad. Simple as that. Google App Engine. The basic thing where we like the most, why Google App Engine? Oh, this. We go live every day on a platform. And no, it's just like, let's go live and take some coffee. I'll show you how it works, but it's a party. You know, imagine having a live platform with kids working on it, and you just go live every day, and it's minutes. So how about what we're doing with Google App Engine and iText? We're using backends and task queues, as I said. I think this talk is too short to dive into it. I can talk for hours there, so it's a little too boring, I guess, but if you're interested, just read the documentation on the URL I'll provide later, because it's quite good documented, quite well documented. We're using the Blob Store, where we have some stuff in there, and we're using the iText encryption tasks. Learnings. You know, we're live now for some time, and the App Engine platform is live now for a few months. And well, what we learned, iText and encryption, the libraries are fast and solid. The bad thing is an App Engine, you need to do it in memory. The streams are not how you want it, so we load the entire thing in memory, encrypt it using the stamper, and send it back again. What's something that is really strange to realize is that the Blob Store is terrible. It's a major pain in the ass. If you send 150 megabytes to the Blob Store, chances are 50% that you get a timeout. So you need to retry your chunks. And you can only send chunks of 1 megabyte at a time, so a lot of stuff there. So you think, like, hey, this is terrible, but then you start coding for retrying, so you make your code be able to work with errors, and at that point, you've created truly reliable software, because at any point, at any time, servers, computers, networks will go down, and the larger your system, the chances multiply if something goes wrong. So it's good to realize the Blob Store is very slow, and it's unreliable. Just code for it. I have code for it. If you want to code how we do it, we can just mail it. It just retry loops, and it's okay. And if the thing fails entirely, the task queue will just retry it 1 second later again, and it will finish. No problem. So, CDN delivery? Oh, yeah. That's quite nice that if you just store it in the Blob Store and you serve your file, it's from the CDN. You don't need to do anything. You don't need to push it anyway. Just store it in your Blob Store, and it's there. It's global. Task queues, well, without task queues, this is really hard to make it solid. On the backends, we're using B8s, which is the fastest machines you can use on Google App Engine, which right now is 4.8 gigahertz. Note that if you have a lot of backend processing power, it's topped out to 10 gigabytes in total. So if you, let's say if you have 10 B8s, that's about the max you can do on backends. On the front end, you can do 1,000 servers. That's another thing. So you can run there too, but this for the backends. Note also that the Play framework, if you use an app engine, is quite slow to boot. 10, 15 seconds, assume that. So if you have a really large spike of traffic, so you need like 100 extra servers, it can take 10 seconds, which is okay for 100 servers, right? But still, you need to know it's there. And we used in the Play framework, we used Objectify, which is a brilliant library from Google in App Engine using Java Plain. In combination with Play framework, and you want multi-threading, you're going to, well, it's not. So don't use Objectify within Play, use Xena. Saves you a lot of time and trouble. Still with me? Still alive? Yeah? Enough oxygen? Okay. Demo time two. Let's see, I'm going to go away and start doing this one. Okay. Google App Engine. This is the live server of what I've shown before. And as you can see, let's see if I can scroll here with the strange last screen. Oh, like this. As you can see this morning, the kit started to connect, so we have like 4 to 10 hits per second averaging. You can see the drops, which are the changes between, you know, all the schools have like the lunch breaks and you can see it. Right now we are running five servers, doing an average of this per second in average, and a response time of 100 milliseconds per call averaging. And my average instance is this, like this. You can see how we use stuff. So we have only 130 gigs of blob storage. We have 8 hours of backend instances running today, 16 hours we spent on this one. Bandwidth is like this. As you can see this, the cost of this today, basically, it's about $1 or $2 a day on hosting we spend. So, scary low. And here you can see more what's happening there. You can see if there are errors. You can drill down to the logs and see what the errors were. So, you know, being a programmer, imagine that you can just code. And if we deploy, it works like this. So we deploy from our Eclipse, and we add a new version. You can see versions here. So this is the live version right now. If we want to go to this version, I push here and we're live. If something went wrong, we go back. If I say, oh my God, what we do when we deploy, we test our code internally and we have unit tests, right? After that, we deploy to a higher version, and then we test on that URL. Every instance has its own URL with a prefix for it, so you can test it for yourselves. After that, we start this, and this is brilliant. We're going to say, let's do version 2 for 25% of traffic based on IP, right? So if I press OK, 25% of all my traffic instantly will go to version 2 and the other one to version 1. Both of the systems have different logs, so we can just check the logs of version 2 to see if some strange stuff is happening and feel with it. Then we go lunch, we just do stuff. A few hours later, we go back, see if it's still OK, and we do the switch. Well, I never want to go back to the old school deploy way, how we normally did it. This is a happy place for us developers, of course. And imagine the time and the money it saves for my customer to work like this. Well, you have a lot of insight in there. So these are the servers running right now. How old are those servers? What are they doing? I can shut down manually if I want, but it's all going automatically. And one funny thing to see is you can do a lot of setups, but one funny thing might be, let's do 675 servers. If I press save right now, 675 servers will start to boot up instantly, and in 15 seconds, I need to pay a lot of money to Google. But you can imagine feeling safe on this, right? I'm not afraid of the September boost on traffic on this one. So this is, you can say, I want those instances anyway, but if you say automatically, it has an algorithm, but it looks to the response time of every server, and if it's slower than, let's say, 500 milliseconds, it will checkmark a new instance, and it will boot every 10 seconds, it will double the instances. So in like 30 seconds or so, you can have 64 extra servers without you even noticing. Well, on the bill, but that's okay. Yeah. So a lot of cool stuff here. I'm not going to dive into everything, but it's, I think it's good to know. Do you guys have questions about this? Cool. Okay, let's go to the iPad version again. Well, this is something you saw before, right? So this is the iPad version. Oh no, it's the HTML version. So we created a PDF renderer, which feels somewhat, well, bandwidth is a thing, somewhat like what we did on the iPad. So you have your script here, you can do stuff, it's all the same. Oh, wait a sec, sorry. You can change books, you can do stuff here. Go home, you have your own stuff, so I can see this and I can... Well, looks familiar, right? This version isn't released yet, so this is still... This is a scoop, so to say. In 1 or 2 weeks, we will be releasing this to the schools too, but of course, iPad, it's a brilliant device, but Apple is a little bit scary. So we have the HTML5 version parallel with that developed too. But it has the same platform, it has the same grasp on the PDFs themselves, and if you type on the web version and you continue on your iPad, the items are there, you have the application somewhere else you can share easily. So this is the interesting part is that the entire Google App Engine platform gives us an easy way to deploy everything to all the different systems without having a lot of power and manpower needed to maintain everything. So I think this is quite cool. As you can see now, my book is already here too. So I don't think the tiling will be ready because... Oh, okay. Tiling is ready. And of course we made some stuff. Because we have keys, we can do a lot of cool stuff with how you can zoom and follow through your documents in a different way than how the iPad should work. Okay. Let's wrap up. How am I doing time-wise? It's okay? Okay, wrapping up. Okay, so this is basically what we're starting on to doing right now, the full text search, but we don't want to do it on the iPad client only. I want to have exactly the same results and search on both platforms. So we bring it to the cloud itself and going to be searched. Because it's not only PDF, it's PDF plus your personal stuff, plus what your teacher asks you to do on that place. So it's not only documents, it's a combined search. So it must be integrated. And we are, of course, working on the new interactive document format, what we're going to use. HTML5 is our most promising call to continue, but we don't know. We just, next couple of months, we're going to decide, play around, do research, and we'll see where we're going. So if anybody has tips, hints, anything, please email me. I'll just fix this one up. So, if you wanted to play with stuff like this, the Play Framework URL where you can just download the stuff and just code easily. It doesn't only run on App Engine, it just runs on any good web server. You can run it on Heroku or anything. But then, if you saw App Engine, it gives you a lot of stuff for only a few dollars. App Engine information is over there. The Timo Meulhof project is tweeting with the Scoretest app as a Twitter account. You can follow them there or this website. There's a lot of cool stuff and videos and research being done, so you can read what we're doing with it and what our next steps will be. Thank you very much.